legacy. In the time where heroes lived, people like Salahuddin, who gave his life for Islam, our legacy.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All praise belongs to Allah, and may His peace and blessings be upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We welcome you, dear viewers, to the third part of our look at the Islamic history of Al-Andalus, or Islamic Spain. Now, in the past two episodes, we looked first of all at the rise of Al-Andalus and the conquest, how the Muslims entered into the Iberian Peninsula. The second episodes, we looked at how they actually lived, how they managed to maintain the land, the ups and downs, looking at how when the Muslims were united, they were strong. And when they became disunited, they became weak. And it was going back and forth, the Murabitun, the Muwahidun, coming to assist the Muslims and then falling back again. We found many, many lessons. What we want to look at today though, inshallah, before we get to the fall of Al-Andalus, is just to take a look at the actual culture and legacy that we have today because of Al-Andalus. Remember, we said the Muslims were in the Iberian Peninsula for 800 years.
And we said that the Cordoba was the biggest city, not only in Europe, or in the world.
Yes, this is something that's definitely something to take note about. It was the largest city in the world. This almost by default implies that Andalus was the richest, most prosperous, and most noble city in the world that everybody looked to.
Musa, you say that this was the golden age.
This was the golden age of Judaism. Some say the golden age of Islam. And when they say golden age, it means in terms especially of technology, in terms of information. As we said that Europe was in, you know, they called it the Dark Ages. But Andalus was like a lighthouse, a pillar of light. People would flock there. They would send their children to study in Andalus. It was the most prestigious place that a person could go. And remember, this happened for 800 years. We said Spain as a nation today, after the fall of Andalus, is only 500 years old. For the majority of the history of Spain and Portugal, these were Muslim lands. So no doubt in these 800 years, you're going to have an amazing legacy. So as we said, Cordoba. Cordoba was the largest city in the world. We find it was the first city to actually be fully lit by streetlights. This is something we take granted for today.
In that time. We are speaking about maybe before 1,000 years.
Going back a thousand years ago.
And what about the European cities? I think that there were dirt in every corner or something like that.
You'd find it was very rare to find, you know, a city with street lights, with security. And most of them, as we mentioned, like as you were saying, they were very dirty. They didn't have the same level of health and cleanliness. You find that there was actually one of the Muslims, when he wanted to build a masjid, what he did, the first thing he did is he tested the quality of the air. He would go to a place, and what he would do is actually get some meat. And he would hang this meat in this place, and he would see how long does it take for this meat to go rotten. And he would find different parts of the city to find the cleanest place in terms of air quality. This is something amazing. Some people, they don't even think about taking this into account nowadays.
Ibn Sina.
Yes. I don't know if it's Ibn Sina at this time specifically. I don't think it was at that
time.
He
isn't from Islamic, but I heard that he did this.
Naam. You found as well, not just, you know, street lights, not just safety, not just universities, but also the cleanliness. You found public baths, you know, the hammam, the trademark of, you know, the North African society. This was found everywhere. This was a time where it said, you know, for example, the Queen of England, she would bathe, you know, once or twice a year. Once or twice a year. And the people would think she was crazy. Why does she need to bathe so often? It's something amazing.
One or twice in the year?
Once or twice in the whole year. And they said, why is she so extreme for? Yet the Muslims would be bathing daily. At least you would have, like the Prophet ﷺ would say, at least weekly, at least for Jumu'ah. Bathe. When you're going to be with people, you should be clean. They upheld this legacy. So what we today take for granted, you know, this cleanliness, this was a staple of Andalus culture. This was taken from the Muslims. You know, the non-Muslims would go there to study, they'd go there to live, and they'd see the streets were clean, the people were clean. You had all of these things, and they would learn from this.
Not only that, I heard that they also had food from all over the world.
Yes. You found that at this point, there's actually something they call the Muslim Agricultural Revolution. You find that foods from all around the world that never existed in Europe actually began to be introduced. You found rice, for example. Before Andalus, rice wasn't known in Europe. The Muslims introduced rice. The paella that you have in Spain today, it was brought by the Muslims. You find even in Italy, that we mentioned in one of the previous episodes.
The oranges, I think that the orange are...
Oranges, we're going to talk about this inshallah, all of these things that they brought. Even a pasta, for example, you find there's a common misconception.
They brought bathroom, because as we said in the second episode, when the barbers came, they destroyed all bathrooms in the Roman Empire. So we can say that the Muslims, they brought once again this bathroom, because we know that in for example in Schönbrunn, it is in Austria. This is the castle, the palace of Austro-Hungarian of Habsburg. They had they built the bathroom in the beginning of 20th century.
Yes, this is, as we were saying, cleanliness. It was absent. The Muslims, they brought this. In Italy, we use the example of pasta. When you think of pasta, you think of Italy. Many people, they have the misconception that pasta came from China. It was said Marco Polo, he saw noodles and he brought them back to Italy. But the reality is, pasta existed long before then. Where it actually came from was from the Berbers of North Africa.
From Berbers?
From the Berbers, the Muslims of North Africa. They had durum wheat. And they brought this wheat and they would make a thing that was very similar to, you know, like spaghetti. Like, because you have couscous, something similar. They brought it to Italy, to Sicily, and this is where you got pasta from.
So Berbers are the... They make up spaghetti and...
They were the fathers of spaghetti.
What about meatballs?
Meatballs, only Italians could invent this.
And Musa, this lifestyle, what you say, in Cordoba, this was also in Arab nations or in Africa, North Africa, this was also there or only in Cordoba?
You find that especially Cordoba. You know, the North African nations, they were the ones, for example, the University of Kairouan. This was the first university in the world. You had Azhar later on. You found this, you know, love for learning, for example, meant that in Andalus, they also had this love for learning. So you found that the first universities in the world, the best universities in the world, so much so the system they came up with from the University of Kairouan, the first university, and it was built by Muslims. The way in which it operates is still how our universities operate today. Not much has changed. This is a legacy of the Muslims. We find in the food, we find in the religious freedom that we talked about, how Jews, for example, Jews weren't welcome anywhere in Europe at that time. But Andalus, they flocked to Andalus. Why? Because they found religious freedom.
And in this way, they also excelled in medicine, I've heard.
Yes, medicine, you found, you know, I remember one historian of medicine. He was actually talking about, he says, if you properly want to study medicine in proper detail, you have to know the Arabic language. Why? Because the greatest, you know, treatises on early medicine were written by the Muslims.
I think that the popes in that time, they didn't love this because, you know, if all books in medicine are on Arabic, why? What we need Latin.
No.
So I think that the Latin was...
What the Romans did was destroyed. With the fall of the Roman Empire, Europe went back into darkness. You know, you can't just, for example, start learning about medicine, say, I'm going to learn today. You need to have the foundation of the society first. You need to be able to have universities. You know, Paris barely even existed as a city at the time, whereas Andalus was developed. You had all of these things. And as we'll mention, even like the religious freedom became a trademark. One of the things that actually happened when Andalus was first founded, the Muslims conquered Andalus. There was a famous event. You had these people that were called the Martyrs of Cordoba.
Yes.
There was a group of Christians. And they decided, no, we can't have the Muslims coming in. So they decided they're going to do everything in their power to abuse Islam so they can be made martyrs. It said there was 48 of them.
Yeah.
So what they would do, for example, They would come to the Muslims and say, is it true that in your religion, if we insult your God and your prophet and your book, that you're going to slaughter us? So the Muslims, they would say, where did you hear this from? And they wouldn't answer the question because they don't want to carry these things out. Just as a Muslim doesn't want to insult other religions, they don't want their religion insulted either. But these people, they knew. So they would publicly insult the Prophet. They would publicly, you know, humiliate the Quran. So much so the Muslims were forced to stop this at the root. So they executed them. And this is the law of the land. You insult the Prophet ﷺ, you will be executed. And they knew this and they wanted to be executed, hoping that they would be made martyrs so that people would, you know, rise
up. Them as heroes.
What did the Christians do, however? They couldn't care less. They said, these people are fools. These 48 martyrs, they're better off dead. We don't care. Because we have more religious freedom under the Muslims than we ever had under the Christians.
So you're saying there was some sort of paramilitary force, so to speak, just, externalizing forces. I guess you could say some sort of external army from the church, per se.
They weren't even an army.
Wow.
Because the church by itself, they, as we were saying, they welcomed the Muslims to a large degree. You had a few small irritants, you know, people who wanted to make trouble. They wanted to inspire the people.
Offshoots, so to speak.
Indeed.
Yeah.
And they did this, they gave their lives for nothing. Because as we said, the people appreciated the rule of the Muslims. They had a freedom you couldn't find elsewhere in all of Europe.
Maybe Christians helped the Muslims to kill that, that troublemakers.
Whether or not this happened or not, Allah knows best, but they certainly didn't cry for them.
And this Jama'ah finished.
How so?
This Jama'ah, Christian Jama'ah, they finished.
Yeah, the martyrs of Cordoba, this was only at the beginning of Andalus. After this, we didn't hear about them again.
Not only that, is it true that many great Islamic scholars came from Andalus?
You had many great scholars of Islam. You had like Ibn Hazm al-Andalusi, for example. You had amazing groups of scholars. Al-Qurtubi, he came from the city of Cordoba. You know, we're talking 800 years. An amazing legacy, and not just amongst the Muslims, as we said. The greatest scholars of Judaism lived in Andalus.
Don't forget Ibn Rushd as well. He is very well known for influencing Western political thought as well as Western philosophical thought in those ages and up until now. He is regarded as the father of philosophical freedom, I suppose, from what I've been reading.
As well as
Ibn Sina as well. From what I've read, he is solely responsible for the modern practice of general medicine up until, from his time until the late or mid 15th century, his books were being used in modern universities around the world at that time,
indeed,
from what I believe.
The Muslims, they laid this foundation because it wasn't present. They set the precedents, and the West later on, you know, once you had the Renaissance, they started to build upon what the Muslims had. You saw, for example, architecture. The architecture of Andalus, most of us have seen, you know, the arches of the Masjid of Cordoba. You know, these beautiful, beautiful masjids with the red and white designs. Now, if you see this design, you'll find this became prevalent all over the Muslim world. You go to Medina today, you go to Masjid al-Nabawi, you'll find the same style arches, except in being in red and white, you find it in gray and white.
Not only that, also in the greatest literature in Western history, like Dante's Divine Comedy, they say that it was influenced by Islamic Sufism.
Yes, but by Ibn Arabi, they said that Dante Alighieri, that his vision of paradise, his vision of hell, is it isn't original. It is a copy from vision of Ibn Arabi.
No, it's well known Dante, who was, you know, the father of the Italian language. He was inspired by Arabic works, and as an insult, subhanAllah, he said the Prophet ﷺ, he included him as a character in his Inferno, you know, saying he's in the hellfire. A'udhu billah. First, he takes from the Muslims, copies them, plagiarizes, and then insults them. Subhanallah. You find
he's so grateful.
Ah, subhanallah.
And similar,
a typical Italian.
Something that was similarly done by the church as well. I mean, the church, you know, collected pieces of Islamic texts and, I mean, libraries and volumes. And, I mean, to this day, you still have them in the Vatican vault, in the Vatican library.
Yeah.
You have these great works of Islamic literature and science and art.
Indeed. And even we know, you know, as we're talking about the Jewish literature, the Kabbalah, for example, you know, the Kabbalah was actually inspired by a lot of the heretical, deviant, Sufi books. the Kabbalah was written in Andalus and taken from them. This is the context in where they were written. You always have to take this into account. Written in the Arabic language. So you found, a lot of the history of Judaism really excelled in Al-Andalus. So as I was saying, you had the architecture. So and this, you know, the masjid, the La Mesquita as they call it. Even after the fall of Andalus, the Christian king, when he saw what the Christians had done, you know, in tearing parts of it down, he said, "What have you done? Trying to turn it into a church." He said, "You've destroyed something beautiful. And never again did you see anything of its like." And they still stand, many of them today. Al-Hamra, you can go and see Al-Hamra today. You can go see the masjid. You can see many of these things. And you don't find anything excelling this architecture. And it left a legacy, even in Melbourne, in my city in Australia. You'll see that there's a style of architecture that's called Moorish Revival architecture.
Yes, and we have this in Bosnia. I think that we have this in all parts of the world, yes.
You find it's very common. And Melbourne is one of the most famous cities for this. Like you have, you know, all of these typical Western-style buildings. Then you got something that looks like, you know, the Sultan's Palace.
Way in Australia.
This is it. This is in Australia. You say, where did this come from? And it's inspired by Moorish or Andalusi architecture. You find a majority of the synagogues that were built in Europe and the USA, they were actually modeled upon masjids. You'll find some synagogues in the USA. If you were to look at the front of it, you'd say, this is a masjid. Looks like it's taken straight from Andalus. As we mentioned, you know, with the, you know, the black and white, the curves, the arches, for example, you find Freemason temples. Masonic temples in the USA, especially belonging to the Shriners, some of them you would look at them and you say, this is a masjid. And they even called it a mosque. There's a Freemason temple. They called it a mosque.
So we can see that the history of Andalus is now in all parts of the world. You can see the part of Andalus living maybe in Australia by these buildings.
Yeah, definitely. And it inspired that much because the architecture was so great. Anyone could appreciate it. Even a non-Muslim would appreciate it. So it's interesting to see how this happens.
When Muslims rule, they give a free atmosphere to create.
Definitely so.
In any subject.
People were welcome. You actually, it was a center of intellectual learning. You wanted to go to a place and you actually could study, you could talk about things, meet others. You'd only go to Andalus. In the rest of Europe, you wouldn't find this. Now, as we were mentioning before, we also had what we called the Muslim Agricultural Revolution. How the Muslims, they started to bring into Europe foods that the rest of the world, coming from the rest of the world, that Europe had never seen before. For example, citrus fruits, lemons, oranges, things like this. And you see there's a common misconception about the country Portugal. Many people, they say the etymology of Portugal, it comes from Portugal, meaning an orange. Because Portugal grew many oranges. So they called it Al-Ard al-Portugal. Mm. The reality, it's the opposite. The orange was actually named after Portugal. Because, you know, it grew so prevalently there. So what we're going to do, inshallah,
And Muslims, they brought with themselves, they brought the orange to Portugal. So we can say that the Portugal must be, it should be grateful to Muslims for the name of their country, Portugal's. People must be grateful to Muslims.
Inshallah, no doubt. What we're going to do is we're going to stop here, we're going to go for a very short break, and we're going to be continuing to discuss the legacy of Al-Andalus that we see today. So dear viewers, stay tuned, and we'll be back after a very short moment.
Our legacy.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, viewers, where we're here looking at Islamic history, focusing on the legacy and the fall of Al-Andalus, the third part of our series looking at the history of Al-Andalus. Now, we were talking about some of the legacy of Al-Andalus, of Islamic Spain, and we saw, for example, foods, the introduction of rice, we saw the introduction of things like apricots, sugarcane, saffron, even cotton, for example. Cotton was introduced to Europe by the Muslims in Andalus, something which really you sort of take for granted. Even some simple things, you know, they sound a little bit strange, such as the concept of a three-course meal. It's almost standard, you go to the restaurant, you have your three-course meal. This was something that was actually introduced in Andalus. There was a very famous person in Andalus, He was very famous for his style. He was one of the, when it came to food, all of these things, he was like a lifestyle type person. The lifestyle man of Andalus, his name was Zirgab. He was the first one to actually make, you know, common a three-course meal. This is amazing. These are things that we can trace all the way back to Andalus. And these are parts of the legacy.
I thought that Frenchmen were which introduced that.
They would have taken it from Andalus. They would have been inspired by this.
So and before this, it was when they're hungry, they eat.
Yeah, you don't have any concept of a nice ordered meal. You know, the people, you know, you just probably eat whatever you had. You know, especially if you're living, you know, like in the Dark Ages, you didn't have the same level of civility and, you know, things like this. So this was introduced in Andalus and brought to the rest of Europe. You saw education. Education was one of the strong points of Andalus. Now compare. You would find, for example, that more books were translated in 1 year. More books were actually translated in a month in Andalus than you find in a year of the whole Middle East today. The translation of books. When you're translating
books...
In
that time, without this technology, without the...
This is copying by hand, no computers. Nothing to help you. You'd find in a single month, you know, they would translate the classics from Latin,
no Gutenberg,
from Greek.
Was Gutenberg, was it? Invented the printing machine?
I know, this came much later.
Yeah.
You
so
didn't
no
have
Gutenberg
any of these.
Those times.
They would copy by hand. You know, all of these classics meant that the Muslims were familiar with this. They revived, you know, many of the Greek sciences. They excelled in astronomy. They excelled in all of these things.
I think that they saved some books.
We could also trace that back to the sunnah of the Prophet, peace be upon him, when he told one of his companions to learn Hebrew in a short amount of time.
Yes. This is something that you have to take into appreciation. And you find as well, you know, actually having a society that spoke many languages. You know, you had Christians who spoke Latin. You had the language of the common people, which was Spanish. But you see, Spanish wasn't like the Spanish of today. Spanish was actually written in the Arabic alphabet. You would find there's many parchments left until today where you find Spanish written in Arabic letters. So if you actually learn, there's a few different rules to the way Arabic's written. For example, in Arabic, we know there's no letter E. You've got the fatha for A, you've got the dhamma for U, you've got the kasra for I. So how are you going to write the letter E? What they would do is they'd write the hamza, for example, before with a fatha, followed by an alif, and this would be an E. Innovating the Arabic language to write Spanish. You found this happening in Italy, all over the world. When the Muslims went to a place, they would bring the Arabic alphabet. And this means the people could read the Quran better. They were familiar with the alphabet.
Yes, we have this in Bosnia also.
The Arabica script. Now you find at the same time, conversely, the enemies of Islam always want to eliminate this. We saw in Turkey, Ataturk, Mustafa Kemal, one of the first things he did is he eliminated the Arabic alphabet and introduced the Latin alphabet. Why? Because this is a part of your culture. When you write in Arabic, when you have Spanish written in Arabic, it's going to make your heart feel a little bit closer to the Arabic language, to the language of Islam. So you saw this is actually available. So this, the legacy of, you know, translating books, having access to the world, having the Muslims educated, and then to compare it to the situation today, where you find, you know, in a whole year, all of the books in the entire Arab world wouldn't be even compared to 1 month in Al-Andalus.
Do you have some traces of Arabic or influence of Arabic language in maybe in Portugal language or in Spanish language?
It's said approximately, you know, you have about 4,000 words of Arabic origin in Spanish today. We mentioned already the place names like, you know, Guadalquivir comes from Al-Wadi Al-Kabir. You have many, many words that actually, they're part of Spanish today that you wouldn't even realize they're from Arabic, partly because they're from the Amiya, the common speech of the people, but also because over time they've changed completely. For example, in Spanish we have a word, heke. If I say heke, you've got to think, what is this? It means sheikh. Why? Because this letter, sha, the sound sha, over time it became replaced. In Spanish today there's no sha. The sha became a kha. So this is why, for example, you find Mexico. Mexico, in the native language of the Aztecs, was Mexico. But now they say Mexico. Same sheikh became heke. You find masjids. Masjid over time, part of the way that the letter ja changed, because you don't have a ja in Spanish. It eventually turned into a ka sound. So from masjids, The J became a K. You got masjid. From here, you get mesquita, the Spanish word for masjids. So you see, there's actually a common misconception that a lot of people, they thought the word mesquita in Spanish was named after mosquito. I've heard this many times.
You have a determined article, Al, from Arabic in some of words in Spanish. I heard for El Nino or something like that. If you have the thing.
The El itself is actually coming from Latin. But no doubt, the fact that the Arabic language, you know, was in the place at a time, you found in Andalusi Arabic, as compared to the rest of Arabic, for example, you have what we call the Shams letters. Like you say Ash-Shams, you don't say Al-Shams, you say Ash-Shams. But in Andalus, they would say Al-Shams. This was peculiar to only Andalusi Arabic. It's the only dialect that you actually found this. And this, you know, no doubt influenced later in Spanish. You still have the same word, El, to say the. Before our words.
You say Cordoba was the biggest town in the world at this time.
Cordoba was the largest city in the
city,
world.
And the population, maybe 1 million.
It did. It was actually, Allah Haram, the first city in the world to reach a million people.
Million. And the language where they will speak, what language they will speak?
You had amongst the Muslims, the majority of them spoke Arabic. They had, you know, you had Fusha, you'd speak in the masjids, and then you had the Amiya. This was called Andalusi Arabic. And many of the non-Muslims, they learned this. They also spoke Latin in the early days, and then later Latin evolved into Spanish. This is why Spanish grew in Andalus, and this is why it has such an Arabic influence. Like in Sicily, we talked, you got Sicily and Malta. It grew among the Muslim rule, which is why Maltese is very, very similar to the Arabic language. So you have a great part of this legacy.
So in Al-Andalus, there was sort of like a melting pot of all these different cultures and everything. So Arabic became the main professional language?
You did. Arabic was the main language in the south. Now, as we mentioned, you know, everything wasn't fine and dandy. You did have, you know, racial issues. You did have the Berbers, you did have a lot of things like this. You also did have in the north, the Basques. Now the Basques until today, they're a fiercely independent people. Now many of the Basques, they embraced Islam. And when, especially the Basques, when they embraced Islam, they were very opposed to what they saw as a very pro-Arab stance. Because once, you know, the Arabs conquered, they were very, we won't say racist, but they saw themselves as being superior sometimes. Unfortunately, not all of them, but some of them would do this. And so you had amongst the Basques a very big movement, you know, talking about saying, from an Islamic point of view, all people are equal. No one is better than another except in taqwa. So they were very opposed to, you know, the pro-Arab stance that a lot of the rulers had. And you find that one of the things that they really used to push was the language. They would say, we have our own language. You can't deprive us of this language. And this is something that you have to understand when you're going into a land. You can't completely replace a language. You find the Prophet ﷺ was someone who appreciated this. When the Muslims came back from Al-Habasha, from Ethiopia, the Prophet ﷺ would speak words in Ethiopian to them. He would speak with the children, speaking Ethiopian to them. He knew this. He knew to take pride in the languages of the people. Don't deprive them of this. And when the Arabs went to these extremes, you know, like we said, the Muwahidun went to extremes in religious rights, taking away, you know, the right for the Jews and the Christians, so too with the language, trying to enforce the Arabic language. This caused a lot of problems.
Because this is leading to racism, and racism is leading to disunity, as I said in many times.
No doubt. And as we saw, the Muslims eventually became disunited. Now, going from here, if we were to talk about the legacy of Andalus, we could talk for days on end about the scientific, you know, the astronomical, all of these things.
All 30 episodes.
We could, but we have to move on from here. You know, we take these lessons and we move, inshallah. We see, we already talked about when disunity caused the Muslims to become defeated. The Muwahidun, after they started to become defeated, the Muslims, they only held a few cities. Until coming closer to 1400, 1450, the Muslims only held one city, which was the city of Granada. Granada was the last Muslim city. Now, it's very well known, the fall of Granada. This happened in 1492. 1492, we also know, was the year that Christopher Columbus, you know, discovered, as we say, he bumped into America when he was looking for India. This is no coincidence. We're going to discuss this a little bit later. and in one of our other episodes in more detail. So 1492, Granada, the Emirate of Granada, is the last city standing. No doubt they can't support themselves. The Khalifa can't send troops. There's no more empire in North Africa to assist them. So the Emir of Granada at the time, his name was Abu Abdullah.
And Muwahidun were there or Khalas, they finished?
The Muwahidun are finished. And now you've only got one Muslim city left.
There was no one in North Africa to help them.
They were weak themselves. They couldn't send troops.
They were disunited in
they,
the North
They
Africa?
Were very disunited themselves. So we see that Abu Abdullah, or as the Spanish called him, Bo Abdil, he was forced, pretty much, to abandon his city. So I said the Christian king and queen, Ferdinand and Isabella, they marched down to Granada and they demanded that Abu Abdullah come give them the keys of the city. You know, showing the humiliation. And it said, you know, the historical accounts, they differ upon this. It was said that they forced him to kiss their hands. You know, he's the Emir of the Muslims, kissing the hand of the Christian king and queen. And Christopher Columbus, he wrote in his diary, he was actually present at the fall of Granada. He said that he kissed the hands of the king and queen. However, another report says that the mother of Bu Abdil said, "You're not going to kiss their hands." And she said to the queen, "He's not going to kiss your hands." You know, his mother's speaking on his behalf, subhanAllah. He wouldn't even speak for himself. His mother had more pride than
and,
he did.
Sheikh, and that's how weak the Muslims were. They would actually go to kiss the non-Muslims' hands.
At this point, they were that humiliated. They've lost everything. They become that disunited. We looked at how they became disunited from abandoning their religion.
And there was no army in this time.
There is no army. There was no one to defend them. He gave the city to them. He gave the pride of the Muslims 800 years of legacy like that given away. Now we see it said that once he gave them the keys, the king and queen, Ferdinand and Isabella, they got off their horses. And they marched over to the cross and they began to worship the cross. We see after Tawheed had been, remember this was the reason why the Muslims entered, to stop this worship of the cross, to stop idol worship, to proclaim the oneness of God and to protect the Jews and the Aryan Christians after 800 years. And because of the Muslims' infighting and weakness, we see the king and queen instantly begin to worship the cross.
And I bet they also started oppressing their own people again.
We're going to see about this, inshallah. We're definitely going to learn. And it was said that instantly the Christians, they began to cry. They began to cry with joy, saying, "Now Andalus is ours." And the Muslims, they also began to cry over their loss. And all they could do was cry. It was said that at that time, instantly, Abu Abdullah, he was ordered to go back to North Africa. The king and queen said, "Get out of our land. You're not welcome anymore." So they began to march down, because Granada, it's not far from the ocean. They began to march down to the sea so they could leave. And as they were leaving Granada at that time, he came up to a hill and he began to look at the whole city of Granada. We're going to go to a very short break, inshallah, and we're going to look at these amazing words that he said, inshallah. So, dear viewers, do join us after this short break. We'll see you after a moment.
A legacy. A legacy.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to your viewers. We're looking at the history of Al-Andalus, our third and final episode, looking at the fall of Al-Andalus. So after 800 years, it's culminated to this. The city of Granada has been handed over by Bu Abdil to the king and queen of Spain. Now, as he was being exiled, it was said that he was marching out of the city of Granada. And as he was marching out, he actually got to like a high plateau. So he had a view of the whole city of Granada. And so he was there on his horse and he started to look at the city that used to be his. The city that used to be the Muslims. The last vestige of 800 years of Al-Andalus. And he began to cry. What could he do? He began to cry. So his mother, subhanAllah, his mother who was more of a man than he was, she said to him, "Ibka al-yawm bika'u an-nisa 'ala mulkin lam tahfadhuhu ka hifd ar-rijal." You cry today the cry of a woman. You cry like a woman over the kingdom which you could not defend as a man. Subhanallah. And this was the fall of Andalus. He left humiliated.
The Moor sigh.
They call it the Moor's last sigh. So this was the culmination of, again, 800 years. All of these lessons in seeing how Islam entered into Andalus, how the Muslims had power and brought light to the world, how they brought the peak of achievement and got rid of shirk and instilled tawheed. But all of this lost because of why? Because of chasing the dunya and your desires. Because of the lack of unity and love for your brother.
Because as we know that in that time, during the siege, they were fighting amongst the princes in Granada.
Yes. So all of these lessons we must learn from Al-Andalus, inshallah.
And what happened for Andalus after this?
Usually you find most people that hear about Andalus, we say 800 years, the Muslims were defeated, they went home and that was it. But reality, the legacy of Andalus continued for many hundreds of years. Many hundreds of years, up until today, the legacy of Andalus we can see. Because the Muslims still remained in Andalus. They were actually called Morescos, taken from the word Moro. Moro, it was taken from the Greek word for a dark person. You called a Moro, a dark person. So this is what the Muslims, they became called. And so the Muslims at that time, they were majority of them for a while had a little bit of freedom, but eventually they were forced to embrace Christianity. So many of them, they had no place to go. They had to stay in Andalus.
Speaking
it was hard to leave.
The Spanish Inquisition.
Yes, this eventually, you know, once the king and queen said, this is enough, you have no more freedom. You know, once the Moors started to revolt, they started to try to get their land back.
They agreed on religion toleration, religious tolerance. When Muslims surrounded the city, the Christians they said that
they said you've got the freedom.
Yes, they said.
Practically speaking, though, after you know 10-20 years,
different story. I mean, the conversos, which were the name given to the Jews, I think, who were had to convert from Judaism to Christianity, and the Moriscos as well. There was no religious tolerance whatsoever. I'm not sure where you heard this from.
They were inspired by the Muslims. 800 years of religious freedom, we'll give it to you too. After 20 years, the Inquisition began.
So the Muslims and Jews could either have the decision to leave, be exiled, or convert to Christianity.
In the beginning, they had that option. You could leave. But after a while, they weren't allowed to leave. You had to become a Christian.
Or you would be
killed.
Well, not so easily.
Suspicion over their belief, whether or not they were true Christians.
Many of the Muslims really, I mean, they were forced to at least nominally become Christians. And they kept contact with many of the scholars of North Africa. And they said to them, look, we're being forced to become Muslims. What should we do? So the scholars would say to them, look, okay, call yourself a Christian. Go to the masjid. Go to the church. Do what they do. When you get home, make your salat. If you can't make your salat in your house, make salat whilst you're walking. Make sajda with your eyes. If you don't have time to make wudu, wipe your hand against the wall and make tayammum. You know, when you get married in the church. But then when you go home at night, have your nikah. You know, when you get buried, you know, put a cross on the thing if you're forced to. But then the Muslims would go home secretly and pray janazah on their behalf. So you say they were humiliated.
It's after 20 years only.
After 20 years, all of this started to begin.
800 years and they go down in 20 years.
Very, very quickly, all of these rites disappeared.
Now, right after the fall of Granada, was an Andalus still a majority Muslim, or was it like half Islamic or and half Christian? Or
by this time, the majority of the Muslims left. They made hijrah to North Africa. They were forced into exile. If you wanted to practice your religion properly, you went back to North Africa. So by this time, the Christians became the majority. And the majority of the Muslims who stayed were forced, at least nominally, to become Christians.
They even forbidden bathing. To bathe.
It was said, because we remember how we said the Muslims were clean, they loved to wash. You know, if you had a bath
because
on...
Because in that time, it was if you are clean, if you are washing yourself, you are Muslim.
This is what they would assume. If you had a bath on a Thursday night, and this is before, you know, Jummah, you know, you could be killed. You could be put in jail for having a bath on a Thursday night. Because this is when the Muslims bathe. Subhanallah. So you saw all of this legacy, the Christians tried to crush it immediately.
So how did this happen? How did Ferdinand and Isabella gain these forces enough to defeat this huge ummah?
As we said, because of the disunity, because of the infighting, because of the lack of iman, this is the main lessons that we take from this. However, the Muslims didn't give up. This is one of the things that we forget. Okay, yes, the they were
Empire,
oppressed.
Several times they tried to help Muslims in Granada, but they were so far.
It was difficult. But even the Muslims in Andalus, from that point onwards, that you know, you had the Moro revolts, the Moresco revolts. And the Muslims who went back to North Africa, we're going to spend a whole episode, inshallah, looking at this. We're going to look at how the Muslims went back to North Africa and continued fighting for the next 200-300 years. They were called the Barbary Pirates. And this continued up until the USA was founded. And it's interesting, I remember, there was a famous a video that was released, you know, at the election between John McCain and Barack Obama. The priest, his name was Rod Parsley, I think it was. He's the priest of John McCain. He actually made a video saying that the nation of America was born and founded with the intention of destroying Islam. And when I first heard this, I thought, what is he talking about? What he's talking about is the legacy of Al-Andalus. Because America, as we're going to learn, was founded in part because of Andalus. And then once it was founded, they found that they were at war with the Muslims of North Africa, who were still trying to fight back and gain Andalus. This is the, you know, the history that's going to be talked about later, because Andalus didn't finish here. The Muslims didn't give up. Until today, many Muslims still have the aspirations of conquering Al-Andalus. It's actually an obligation, generally speaking. Once a land has been under the rule of the Muslims, it is the obligation of the Muslims to free this.
There's some more Spanish people who are, returning to Islam.
Alhamdulillah, you have people embracing Islam, and you still have, you know, after this, the raids of the Berbers of North Africa continuing to fight, the bombing in Madrid, which happened only not too long ago. If you look at this as an isolated event, you're going to say, why did this bombing happen? Of course, we don't try to justify this, but the ones who did this justified it, saying this is a continuation of Al-Andalus, of the reconquest of Andalus.
Is there still, in today's world, a good-sized Islamic community in Spain?
So the Islamic community in Spain is very small now. You know, you have just a few immigrants. You have in Madrid, for example, a lot of Muslims. In the south, in Andalus, you do have a few, but it's very small.
In the couple of last years, the immigrant population in Spain is increased from about 100,000 to at now about 2 million.
Whether it's 2 million or not, Allah knows best. I wouldn't be surprised. You know, the Muslim community there is growing, but they don't have rights. You'll find that the just recently there was a masjid rebuilt. I think it was in the city of Granada. It was the first masjid built since 1492.
Yes, 1992. It was the first masjid that has been built.
Since 1492. It took that long to build one masjid. This goes to show the rights that the Muslims have today. There's not much freedom. The majority of the Muslims who you meet from Spain don't know their religion. Why? Because in the past we came as righteous conquerors. Now we come today as impoverished immigrants. You see the difference. You see how the Muslim lives with honor and lives with defeat and the causes of this.
It's interesting that nowadays the Muslims are going from Muslim countries to Christian countries to get help, to get the protection. And in the past, we can see that the Christians were going to Muslim countries for protection.
Yes. To find this freedom, we're going to smash a lot of these myths nonetheless later when we're actually looking at the US, looking at Australia, inshallah, looking at Europe. But nonetheless, that is the situation. You know, the fortunes have changed. Now, the legacy of Andalus, as we said, it carries on for the next few hundred years, the Barbary Pirates, which is going to astound you once we talk about the history of this, inshallah. It continues even up until the USA. Another main point, which we're going to be looking at in our next episode, inshallah, is the history of Islam in the Philippines. Because we know the Philippines was conquered by the Spanish. And the Philippines at that time, a lot of the Philippines was Muslim. And when the Spanish came, what did they call the Muslims? They called them Moros. Why? Because they took this name from the Muslims of Spain. And they saw Muslims in Philippines, they called them Moros. Christopher Columbus, when he founded America, remember in 1492, we're going to talk about this when we look at USA, inshallah. He said in his personal diary, when he traveled to Cuba, he found Moros. He found Muslims. He found the mezquita. He found the masjid. in Cuba.
It was said that it's because of Zhenghe. It was said that it was because
Zhenghe came to the other coast. He came through the Pacific coast. Columbus came through the Atlantic coast from the other side. So you found Muslims on both sides of America, subhanAllah.
So even during that time, there was an Islamic community in Cuba?
At that time, you had in the Caribbean Muslims.
And, so we can say that Columbus didn't discover America. He discovered Muslims in America.
He discovered Muslims. You know, this idea of the discovery. You know, imagine someone comes and joins us at the moment. You can't say he discovered us. We've been here for the last hour, and he wasn't even looking for us. He was looking for something else. This is Columbus. He was looking for a way to get to India, and he got lost. He got lost, and he bumped into America, and that's why he called the people Indians. He thought he was going to India. He thought he was in India. He said to them, "You're Indians, and I'm discovering you, and I'm conquering you in the name of Ferdinand and Isabella of Spain." It's almost comical to see. But what's amazing, again, we're going to talk about this in a little bit more detail, inshallah, when we look at the USA, is his crew, the crew of his ship, were Muslims.
I actually heard that his right-hand man was a Muslim.
His right-hand man was a Muslim who actually rebelled against him. Because remember, this was 1492. Andalus had just fallen. He's got a crew of Muslims who were forced to become Christians.
In that time, the Muslims were the best men in the navigation, in the nautical...
Columbus was using their maps. His maps were taken from the maps of the Muslims. He was using the money of the Muslims, using the crew of the Muslims. And when they actually set sail, you know, looking for India, bumping into America, his crew said to him, "Columbus, we're Muslims, and we're not going to accept you." And they tried to fight against him and overthrow him. And they declared a jihad against Columbus on the ship. There's an amazing part of history that a lot of people don't know about.
Why we not listened to this before?
Because we don't know about it. Unfortunately, we've abandoned a lot of this history.
Why do people try to cover up these facts of history? All people know is that Christopher Columbus founded America. They don't know all these details.
Because as we were saying in our introduction episode, history is a political weapon. You know, when a lot of people started to discover, for example, the history of Islam in the USA, you know, before Columbus, many people tried to cover this up. You know, there was a book in one of the libraries in Boston which actually talked about the history of the Muslims, you know, before Columbus. This book had, you know, they put it on a glass security case. So they had security guards defending a book because many people wanted to destroy this book. I mean, you can't change what happened in history, but you can hide it from the people. Because if you tell the people that America has an Islamic history, there were Muslims in America before Columbus, this changes the way that you're going to think about America. Australia, there were Muslims in Australia long before Captain Cook, you know, sailed into Australia. Many Australians aren't aware of this. You tell them this, it redefines what Australia is.
Because, for example, they are telling that this rebellion was made because the journey was too long, because they're trying to change the history, but you cannot change what happened.
You can't change what happened, but you can reinterpret it. Yes, it's not going to change, but you can, the history you can't change, but you can try to reinterpret it. And this is, you find, you know, history is, it's like a battlefield. People fighting over it constantly, trying to take from here and trying to take from here, trying to prove your points. You know, we look at Andalus from the Islamic perspective. We look at its high achievements. Someone else, you know, for example, the common, a commoner from Spain today, he's going to look at it from a completely different perspective. You know, he's told that Ferdinand and Isabella, you know, freed him, liberated him. But we see even them...
Liberated him from the bathing.
Yeah, liberated him from bathing. SubhanAllah. This is how we will look at it. From them, they're going to say, no. They gave us our freedom to worship the cross, you know, for example. They're going to look at it from this perspective. But the reality is, we know, looking at it, even from a neutral perspective, everyone is going to say, I remember there was the words of a Christian historian. He said, when Andalus was destroyed, when the Muslims were driven out, it's like they had killed the goose that laid the golden egg. You know, there's this fable, the goose that lays the golden egg. You know, why would you want to kill a goose who lays golden eggs? This is what they did. When the king saw what they did to the masajid, he said, you've made something beautiful, something ugly. You've taken away something that was so nice, and you've destroyed it. And this was the metaphor for Andalus. You've killed the goose that laid the golden egg. the light that was in Spain for all of Europe, you've extinguished it. Where
wealthiest
is Spain today?
Country in the Europe.
The wealthiest, most prosperous. Where is Spain today? Since Al-Andalus, when has Spain had honor? The closest thing they've had to honor is winning the World Cup. Before this, there was no honor. Spain had a decline, like we saw in Sicily. As we said, you know, the rates of literacy were higher under the Muslims than they are today. So too, Spain, the honor of Andalus, it's never been achieved. Only looking back, you know, the Andalusians especially, looking back and having this honor, that's the closest thing they can have, you know, to having a little bit of pride and understanding today. So we've looked at the conquest of Andalus and how the Muslims conquered it when they were strong and holding on to their religion. We've looked at how infighting and disunity caused their defeat. Of course, these are the main lessons we would want to take from this, inshallah. And as we said, it's not enough just to say this is what happened in Andalus. This is what happened back then. What we want to do is understand this in our own lives, in our own communities. From the introduction episode, we said we don't want to just know about the history. It's not enough to say, you know, Andalus was conquered in, you know, 711. It fell in 1492. We don't want you to know this. We want you to know why it was conquered and why it fell. We want you to take those lessons and implement them in our own lives, in our own understandings. This is as Allah, when He tells us a story in the Quran, He doesn't want us to know specifically about the names, the places and times. We find, for example, an example that's commonly raised is the Ashab al-Kahf, the people of the Kahf. What were their names?
How many were them?
How many? The people they ask, how many were they? Is this really important?
This is not the point.
This is not the lesson that Allah wants us to take. You can know their names. You can know what clothes they were wearing. You can know what they ate for lunch that day. It really doesn't matter. This is not what's important. Allah wants you to take the lesson. Allah wants you to take the understanding. So too, when we take a look at Andalus, we take a look at all of this history, these are the main points that we want to take from it. So no doubt, inshallah, Andalus is a lesson of unity, the importance of unity, the danger of disunity, the imperativeness of holding fast to your religion. And what happens when you abandon your religion?
I'm going down.
You're going to be defeated. You're going to be humiliated. These are definitely the points that we understand from this. So we hope, inshallah, every one of us will take these words of advice to heart, learn these lessons that Allah has given us in the 800 years of history of Andalus. Look forward, inshallah, to learning the history of after Andalus and how it affects us today, inshallah. And we hope you, the viewers, have enjoyed looking at this three-part series on the history of Al-Andalus and joining us, inshallah, for the rest of the episodes, looking at the history of Islam. We hope you've benefited as much as we have. May Allah reward you all and see you in the coming episodes. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.